Hello guys, this is part 1 of my DIY milling project. In this video series I'm going to show you how I built my milling machine from scratch using my lathe, a welder and a 3D printer. Let's start with a quick overview. This mill is belt driven. I'm using 3D printed pulleys for that. The motor is a reused water pump I had laying around. Also, I bought one of these cheap milling machine tables with a table measurement of 475 mm by 150 mm. The travel distance is 335 mm on the x-axis and 185 mm on the y-axis. The z-axis I built has a travel distance of 290 mm. The spindle uses an MK3 Morris taper to allow the use of a wide variety of tools. But more on that later. Let's get started then. At first I bought a 100 by 100 mm square tube and cut it down to size with an angle grinder. Then I started to cut two 68 mm holes using a hole saw and my cordless drill. As you can see, there will be a 60 mm steel shaft inserted later on. It serves as the arm of the mill where the motor and the spindle head will be mounted. Since the holes are bigger than the shaft, I had to turn a bushing out of brass with an outer diameter of 68 mm and an inner diameter of 60 mm. The bushing was just press fitted with a rubber hammer. Also, I made sure that it is equally spaced on both sides. As the next step, I started welding the ground plate to the square tube. In my case, it's a steel disc with about 320 mm in diameter and 20 mm thickness. Next up, I started to add this U-section piece onto the column. I was actually quite lucky to find that on a local marketplace because it has already got a mill top surface. That's why I used it to mount the linear rails for the Z-axis later on. Of course, I just could have mounted the rails onto the square tube directly. But the surface of such tubes is not very flat. This could lead to jamming and inaccuracies when you're trying to move the axis. I started by clamping the U-section onto the square tube and drilling 22 8.5 mm holes through both parts. Once that was done, I separated the pieces and started to countersink and cut M10 threads. Because I'm using countersunk screws, I had to drill countersunk holes for that. Honestly, it is not necessary to use that many screws, but it sure does look good. Now I was able to mount the U-section onto the column with my impact driver. In order to get this pile of parts into a working machine, it is important that the arm of the mill is squared to the travel surface of the Z-axis. Here you can see how I checked that. This is surely not the best way of doing that, but it's easy. The difference between the highest and the lowest point I measured was about 0.3 mm. The axis of the spindle is approximately at the height of measurement 2. That means I got a failure of about 0.15 millimeters. I got that number down to a hair under 0.1 millimeters by putting some shims under the U section. After that, I added two of these spaces to fill the gaps on the sides of the square tube. I just ground that blue shape down with an angle grinder, cut it down to length, and drilled some holes on the sides. Then I cut some threads. This works really well with an impact driver. And here you can see the finished assembly. Remember the brass bushing for the arm of the mill? Well, if you apply force while milling in the Y direction, there is the possibility that the bushing moves. We don't want that here, so I made two covers for it. One for the front and the other one for the backside. They hold the bushing in place. Another benefit of these parts is that the column looks much nicer now. The arm of the mill is able to rotate inside of the bushing. I want to keep it that way, so I'm able to mill faces and other operations at an angle. But also there has to be a way to lock the arm into place. For that I drilled four holes and added locking screws to them. To be honest, a much better way of locking a shaft into place is like they did on that picture of a drill press. If you tighten these two screws, the force you are applying grabs the quill around its circumference and is better distributed. If I run into problems with my design, I might add something similar in the future. As the next step, I drew a curve on both sides of the column using a template. If you're wondering why I'm doing that, it's because, as you can see in that picture, I'm not able to turn the arm of the mill because the white plate would collide with the edges of the column. So I need to cut them off. And the curve just looks better than a straight cut in my mind. Now I wanted to add a sheet metal lid to close the top of the column. And after two scrap parts, I finally got a result I considered to be okay. And with that, the column was more or less done. Later in the project, I added two pieces of flat iron on the sides of the column to stiff it up a little.
Well, that's it for part 1. Let me know if you liked it. In part 2, I will show how I made the head and the spindle, and if the video is not too long, probably even the belt drive. Thanks a lot for watching.